wanted to start this morning talking a little bit about what's different about blindness, but I want to start with something else first.
To everything, turn, turn, turn. There is a season, turn, turn, turn. And a time
Pete Seeger.
To every purpose under heaven. A time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to reap, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to laugh, a time to weep. To everything, turn, 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 there is a season, turn, 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 and a time to every purpose under heaven.
So that was just to kind of give you a sense of what it feels like for me to be here again after probably over 25 years, maybe over 30 years when I think about it. It's just my connection with NAPVI has gone back a long way. And when we think about what happens with families, it's part of the cycle of life, it's part of the cycle of parenting. And for me, it feels like part of the cycle of my professional career that I'm here today. I wanted to talk about what's different about learning for kids who are visually impaired. And back in 1997, I wrote a piece for the book called Equals in Partnership, which I saw on the Perkins table yesterday. I'm not sure if NAPVI sells it, but I think it's the best thing I ever wrote. So I wanted to share that with you and talk about why I think it's so good. What's different about learning for kids who are visually impaired? It's about how, not about what you can learn, because you learn differently when you have a visual impairment. How do blind or visually impaired children experience the world? That's the thing that I think we want to concentrate on. They rely on other sensory information. If you walk into this room and you have sight, you immediately get the sense of how large the room is, where the tables are. This morning you could find the food by yourself just by using your vision. You know where the furniture is, you know how to find a seat, you can find people that you know very easily. For a sighted person, that kind of information is instantaneous and automatic. It happens without you're thinking about it, it just happens. For people who are visually impaired, it's a longer process. It requires input from others, it requires using your other senses to get a sense of the room by using echoes and listening for voices, smelling where the food is. All of those other senses come into play as you're coming into this room. For sighted people, people with vision, it's an immediate and a complete gestalt. That you see the whole picture at once. You get all the details. After you see that whole picture, you can focus in on the details. You're going from holes to parts. For visually impaired children, the opposite happens. So think about it not just from a visually impaired adult who has experience and knows what to look for and what to hear, what to listen for, and so forth, but for a child, somehow they've got to put all these little pieces of information together. The information comes in bits and pieces. It comes from several sources, both touch, smell, hearing, kinesthetic information, haptic information, but they're going from parts to wholes. It's the exact opposite of the way a sighted person learns. It's sort of like putting together a jigsaw puzzle without knowing what it's supposed to look like at the end. You've got to see how those pieces fit together. Information through senses other than vision is not really always, I should say, reliable. It's inconsistent. So the refrigerator sometimes makes noise and sometimes doesn't. The air conditioner sometimes makes noise and sometimes doesn't. Some things produce an odor and then sometimes they don't produce an odor. So how do you got to put all these things together. So it's fragmented. It's coming in those bits and pieces and it's often passive. It's not under the child's control. The only thing that really is under the child's control is touch. They can choose to touch or they can choose not to touch. And that's, you see a lot of kids who are what is euphemistically called tactily defensive, I prefer to call it tactily selective, that they're choosing what to touch and what not to touch because that's the only thing under their control. The other things that are happening, if you have vision, it also is not passive, because if you want to shut your vision, can you shut your vision? If you want to close off your vision, you just shut your eyes. You can't shut your ears. So sometimes you see kids that will try to get around all of that noise and do sort of selectively listen, and even when before they're teenagers, they'll do that. But they do that purposely, I think, because they're trying to focus in on what's important. When all that information is coming at you, when it's in these discrete little fragments, and you don't know yet how it all fits together, it takes a while. It requires practice, training, and time to sort it all out. It does not happen overnight. So some of the things that I said in this piece that I wrote for the Equals in Partnership book is kind of some principles that I try to focus in on and that I hope you will too. The first is to make no assumptions. Never assume that just because a child has been exposed to something that they have learned it. It takes time for that to happen. We talk a lot in our field about incidental learning, that children with visual impairment have difficulty with incidental learning because they can't do things, they can't see things that are happening. They can't observe. Their period of observation is different, their focus of observation, because they have to use their other senses. They can vocally imitate, but can they do other sorts of imitation? So bear with me for a minute, but I want you to do what I do. La 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 la. Okay, close your eyes. You're not doing what I'm doing. You can open your eyes now. That physical movement, you couldn't see because your eyes were closed. And think about for a kid who's visually impaired. How do we expect them to learn to walk if they're not observing other kids walking, if they can't imitate that physical movement? They have to learn because you teach them, or their teachers teach them, but somebody has to show them what the expectations are. They can't observe it happening. Vision reinforces or confirms learning. So even if you say ball, when you're saying ball, you are holding it in your hand and you're saying to your child, here, have a ball. You probably don't say it like that. How does the child can put that word ball, that symbol, the word symbol for ball, together with the ball unless they touch it? And then you use those things again. But for a child who's visually impaired, when you throw the ball to them and you talk about balls, it's for a child who's not visually impaired, it's more of an automatic process. It's a disadvantage for kids who are visually impaired to try to put all of their world together from infancy. Learning cannot be left to chance, and I don't think we should. Remember that learning proceeds from parts to wholes. Visually impaired people rely on many discrete pieces of information, but they're limited by what can be touched or felt or heard or smelled at any point in time. Think about the cow, and this is one of the examples I gave in the book. I happen to love cows. I grew up on a dairy farm. My father was a milkman. But what are the things about cows that allow kids to generalize from one cow to other animals? It has four legs, it has a tail, two ears, two eyes, and a mouth, and a very long tongue. How do you explain an udder, or how a cow chews the cud, without allowing the child to touch and examine a cow? So how do you get close enough to a cow to do that, unless they're in a barn or in their milking machine or something? And then think about it from the child's point of view. The child is limited to what he or she can feel with both hands at one time. So it is difficult to get that concept of animal, cow, udder, milk. You can only feel so much at once. So that concept of cow leads to the larger concept of animals or mammals, and to the larger concept of the food chain and all the processes that goes through with the cow, that happens with the cow that you eat, the cow that becomes feed for other animals, the cow that produces manure for your garden. Think about that smell for a child who's visually impaired when they smell it in your garden versus when they smell it on the farm. How confusing that must be for them. So I love my cows, but my cows are difficult. They don't comply. So use concrete objects. Visual impairment limits the opportunities to develop symbolization, which leads to abstract thinking, which leads to reading. So you want children to try to start putting concepts together, and you have to help them build those concepts. Abstract thinking is at the heart of all learning, and we have to get kids to that point. It begins very early in life. So another example is a stuffed animal. Does a stuffed animal, a cat stuffed animal, or a cow stuffed animal, feel anything like the cow in the barn? No, it's totally different. Not only is it not breathing, it doesn't have the odors that go with cows. It doesn't have the milk. Maybe some do. I haven't seen any, but none of that is there. So expect a child to be able to put the concept of cow in the barn to cow that I'm holding in my hands is really difficult because it doesn't have the same sensory qualities. And we see that a lot when we're teaching kids different concepts, that even if you think about a ball is different. There are different kinds of balls. There are different shape. Football, soccer ball, baseball, all of those are balls, but they all feel different. So how does the visually impaired child learn how to do that except by constant explanation, constant exposure, and just doing it over and over and over again? Nothing can be taken for granted, I don't think, when we're working with kids who are visually impaired. Another principle that I use is to adopt the child's point of view. Be aware of your own senses and how your other senses contribute to learning. Tell them about them. Explain what those different senses, sensory experiences are. A department store has another feel. If you think about it, from it's wide open spaces sometimes, or it's very crowded spaces sometimes. So how do you know one department store is the same as another? A pet store has its own smells and sounds that need to be explained. So it's, in some sense, it might seem like it's a big job as parents, and it is a big job because you have to help the child make those connections, because they don't happen automatically. You want to help your child make connections. You want to interpret these sensory stimuli for your child, help him or her make sense out of all the simultaneous information. But you have to be aware of them first. You have to know what to point out and what's not necessary. Another principle is try it yourself. See if you can do it, and see if you can do it with your eyes closed, and how you can do it. How will you adapt this skill, whether it's pouring from a cup or eating with a spoon or walking, when you don't have the visual feedback that kids who have sight can do? You want to use a multisensory approach. You want to think about what you want your child to learn from the child's point of view. What's important about stacking blocks? Is it the stacking blocks? If we talk about kids who have sight, when you're stacking blocks, you're looking at vertical orientation. What's important about stacking blocks for a kid who can't see? It might be that stacking cups is more important, or stacking saucers is more important. It's not necessarily stacking blocks. So you have to think about the critical feature of all of these skills that we expect kids to do, and what's important for a child who's visually impaired. You also want to relate the experience to the child's own experience. And doing that can make the difference between rote memorization, and you've heard your kids do a lot of rote repeating back to you what they've heard, and that's okay because that's a normal part of development. Kids with visual impairment might stay in it a little bit longer, but what you want to go for is true understanding, and go get beyond that rote memorization to understanding. Another principle is to think outside of your box. So lots of times, there was a movie called Face that was, Cher was in it, and her son had a, I forget which, mask, face mask, sort of close. But remember that illustration when he was with the young woman who was blind, and she was trying to make him think of, or he was trying to make her think about what clouds are like. And what did he use? He used cotton balls. Is that really what clouds are like? I don't think so. Now, what he could have done in that situation, I think he made a good thinking on his feet, but really when you're talking about clouds, wouldn't it be better to talk about fog and walking through fog and what that experience is like? Because that's what a cloud is really like. It's not like cotton balls. So I think it requires us all to sort of get outside our comfort zone and think about things that are a little different. Also important to address children by name. How does a child with visual impairment know that he or she is being spoken to, or that there is an expectation for that child to respond, unless you use the child's name so the child knows that you're talking to him or her? It may not be as big an issue at home, especially if you have only one child, but if you have multiple children, it will be an issue. And when you go to school, it's going to be an issue for your child. So it's important not just for you to do it, but for your teachers to do it. Because if you don't, then your child might speak out of turn because he thinks he's being addressed when it's really addressing the child next to you, next to him, or the child across the room. And how does a child who's visually impaired make that distinction unless the name is before that, before the command or before the instruction? Kids with visual impairment can use eye contact. I'm sorry, kids without visual impairment can use eye contact to know who's being addressed and who is expected to respond. Kids with visual impairment need another cue, and that cue is not having the name. You want to use your voice in general to provide clues, to set limits, and to establish expectations for your child. Think about how many of you were raised by the crook of your mother's eyebrow. Yeah, you knew what to do and what not to do because of that eyebrow. For kids who are visually impaired, it's not that simple. They need some other cues. One of the other things I'm reminded of is I went to school with the University of Pittsburgh in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and there's a school for the blind there, and I was driving home one day and saw a bunch of kids with their canes on the street, and all of a sudden one of the girls pulled up her skirt and pulled down her slip. And I'm thinking, nobody ever told her that you don't do that on the street. That at least my mother would say, don't do it on the street. So, you have to learn those things. You don't scratch your crotch in public. You know, those kinds of things we take for granted, perhaps, because we can see, because we've grown up with our mother's eyebrow, but kids who are visually impaired don't necessarily have that information. Also allow time. It takes longer to do things. Give the child time to accomplish things on his or her own. Sometimes you don't have the time to do that, and that's okay. But try to do it as much as possible. I had one of my first students, and the student that I dedicated my book to, came to visit me. Her parents gave her a trip to New York City for her high school graduation, and she stayed with me. And one day we were going to go to the Bronx Zoo, and we needed to get up 2 hours ahead of time because she needed to wash her hair, and her hair was very long, and she needed to iron. And I could have done it for her, but she needed to do it for herself. And she did, and we got to the zoo. And this child was just amazing. And she had beautiful long hair. Use the child's body as a reference point. Children are familiar with their own body first before they're familiar with other bodies, or before they can say, I can point to my shoulder before I can touch your shoulder and be able to do that. You have to have that experience of knowing what's on your body before you understand what's on someone else's body. So you want to teach body parts, you want to teach body planes, so front and back. You want to teach laterality, right and left. Interestingly, I'm working on a test with the American Printing House for the Blind called the BAME Test of Basic Concepts. And right and left is not in the preschool version, but it's in the school age version. And when we tested the kids, we added it to the preschool version because we thought that's an important concept for kids who are visually impaired. And it's really being addressed in curriculum much earlier than it is for school age kids. And what we found, amazingly, was that every child who was visually impaired in that 4 to 5 year age range was able to tell you right and left, or to point it out correctly. So that was really amazing, and those kinds of things, I kids who are involved in programs early on are able to make those kinds of generalizations and develop those concepts. You want to use body parts perhaps for directions because, again, it relates it to the child's own body. So the coffee, well, kids wouldn't be drinking coffee. I probably should say the cups are on the shelf to your right about shoulder level. Or your toy is in back of you. Things like that, that again, put it in the child's perspective, relationship to the child's body. Try to capitalize on past experiences. I see I've put some kids to sleep, huh? So try to relate what they're learning new to what has happened before. So the trash can is over by the door where you came in to the right. This computer game uses the mouse the same way your other game did. Or, yesterday we had scrambled eggs for breakfast, but today we're going to have fried eggs. There was this neat little, I think it was a slide presentation that was put together by a woman named Sherry Rayner, who was from Michigan, back in the 80s, and it was called The Egg. And when we think about the egg, we can see the raw egg, we can see the scrambled egg, we can see the hard-boiled egg. There are tons of ways to prepare eggs. But how does the visually impaired child know it comes from the same raw egg? Again, we take it for granted, and you can do that perhaps with kids who have vision, but you can't do it for kids who are visually impaired. They need to experience the egg that's raw and gooey in their hands, and the cooked egg and the hard-boiled egg and all of those different ways of thinking about an egg before they really have the concept of egg. Make your child a doer, not a done-to-er. It's often tempting and sometimes quicker to assist by doing things for your child, like tying a shoe, like ironing your clothes before you go to the zoo, buying lunch, typing a term paper as they get older. I guess now computers have made that a lot easier. But it's equally tempting for the child to allow this to be done. It's a risky business because sometimes it leads to dependency and self-fulfilling prophecies, which in turn can lead to a low self-concept for a child who's visually impaired. So make your child do things. Don't let things be done to your child. And remember that your child is a child first. Children who are blind or visually impaired are children first with the same demands, the same desires, dreams, and delights that all children have. But there is no doubt that they require a different style of education, one that creates opportunities to learn rather than waiting for the opportunities to create themselves.
Your children are not your children. They are the sons and the daughters of life's longing for itself. They come through you, but they are not from you. And though they are with you, they belong not to you. You can give them your love, but not your thoughts. For they have their own thoughts. They have their own thoughts. You can house their bodies, but not their souls. For their souls dwell in a place of tomorrow, which you cannot visit, not even in your dreams. You can strive to be like them, but you cannot make them just like you. Strive to be like them, but you cannot make them just like you.
That was Sweet Honey in the Rock, an a cappella group from Washington, D.C., but that particular song was, the lyrics were written by Gibran, which I think is really a beautiful piece, something for us all to remember. Next, I want to take you to Reach Out and Teach. In Reach Out and Teach, there's much more, many more of these stories and longer stories of the ones that I'm going to quote from, but I wanted to read some of them to you today. First of all, from Carl Augusto, who lives in New York. Actually, he lives in New Jersey. When my parents discovered, when I was 8 years old, that I had a progressive eye disorder which would lead to total blindness and that it was hereditary, they were devastated and overwhelmed with guilt. It became a family secret. No one talked about it, and I was overprotected from an environment that they thought would be cruel. The high expectations that everyone seemed to have of me diminished as my vision diminished over the course of time. Two major lessons are, one, don't overprotect your child. Normalize his or her environment and get him or her to interact with non-disabled children. 2, don't have low expectations. Expect that your child will achieve to his or her maximum potential and live in the mainstream of community life. Even those with multi-disabling conditions have greater potential than most parents believe. Parents shouldn't focus on what their children can't do, but on those things they have the ability to do with proper support. And this is a picture of Carl with his family, and then a picture of Carl as a young boy playing baseball. He goes on to say, being a parent of a blind or visually impaired child is not easy, but don't quit. Change doesn't occur overnight. It will take time. Be patient with your child and with yourself. Remain your child's coach and anchor. Finally, show love constantly. My parents didn't always know how to do the right thing, but their love overshadowed their shortcomings. And then from Kim Avila in Virginia. Unconditional love. See, there's a theme here. Unconditional love is the most valuable gift a parent can give a child. No matter how circumstances present themselves, no matter how wealthy or poor you are, and regardless of how your child's educational and other life experiences turn out, a child who knows a parent's love will always have a safe place to seek comfort, a strong foundation to base other relationships, and a lifetime full of fond memories. Accomplishing a task for oneself by oneself is a true triumph. Patience is not a virtue. Patience comes from setting reasonable expectations and goals for your child, knowing how to break down tasks into more manageable components, and being wise enough to realize when both you and your child need a break. And here's a picture of Kim with her family. Kim was a master's student of mine at the University of Northern Colorado, and she married Jonathan, who was one of my babies when I taught in Virginia. So, very special relationship. Ann Korn, many of you may have heard of, and has low vision. In my experience, if there were only 4 areas on which I would place emphasis, they would be on social-emotional development, orientation and mobility, independent living skills, and use of functional vision for students with low vision. There are often a lot of balancing decisions to make. How much to reach out to others and how much privacy your family desires. How much assistance your child needs and how much time should be allocated to learn disability-related skills. Melissa Green was another former student of mine. She writes, teach your child to be proud of his blindness and do not feel sorry for him. The professionals aren't always right. We're not always right. Even as I stand here today, I'm not always right. Do not coddle, baby, or overprotect your child. Involve other family members, and finally, network with other parents and blind children. Richard Jackson from Massachusetts, some of you here may know. Richard was actually a doc student when I was a master's student, and he greatly influenced my training back as a master's student. I was 4 years old when I first realized that I was different from others in important ways. Others could see and do things with relative ease. Many things I couldn't see at all, while other things I could see only by holding them close to my eyes. This difference struck me as very negative. My years of disengagement from school left me with few educational accomplishments. Trying to catch up in public high school in the early 60s proved too daunting. Now more open to advice, I decided to complete my final year at Perkins School for the Blind. What Perkins did for my confidence and self-esteem was truly amazing. Notwithstanding all the gaps in my education that had to be filled during that short period prior to college, my journey through American International College, Harvard, and Columbia Universities would not have been successful were it not for Perkins teachers and faculty mentors who supported me along the way, believing in me before I could believe in myself. So, the little boy, so ashamed of being visually impaired, fruitlessly trying to pass as normally sighted, no longer wanted to be like everybody else. By age 3, most little ones want to be autonomous and powerful. That need to stand out gets transformed in both positive and negative ways through the life cycle. I feel fortunate to have come full circle with the knowledge that I'm not like everybody else. And as it's turned out, that's more than okay. Galen Kapperman from Illinois. So many times, parents are reluctant to let their children know the facts about their eye condition. This sends a false message to the child that blindness is a shameful thing that cannot or should not be spoken of. That concept, of course, is false. The youngster's eye condition should be spoken of matter-of-factly, just like any other characteristic that he or she may possess. And then I gave a full page to this picture of Galen, both as an adult with his guide dog and as a little boy in his cowboy outfit. My favorite picture. Martin Monson from Tennessee, one of my doctoral graduates. Growing up with a vision impairment was normal to me. Everybody else just had really good vision. Having limited vision, 20/200 in one eye and light perception in the other, did not make me feel disabled, impaired, handicapped, or any other term society has used to describe people with my visual acuity during the past 40 plus years of my life. My wife and children don't love me any less. My job, he's a school administrator, holds me to the same standard as everyone else. Who I am and what I've accomplished can be traced directly back to my parents and their expectations for me. I often heard my parents say, "You'll never be a jet pilot or a truck driver, but you could be president." And then from he has more to say. Have high and realistic expectations for your children and the children you work with. No one knows what they will achieve, but they need the message of those around them to be consistent and say that they can and will achieve whatever it is they want to achieve. And now from Martin's father, Tom. We never treated him any differently than anybody else and told him that he was going to live in a sighted world. The only thing that would hold him back was himself. He was capable of doing anything he wanted. From Gary Mudd in Kentucky. He wrote this to his parents. "Congratulations. I want to be everything you expected, but I need your help. Maybe a little more at times and other times different. Help teach me about love and respect for myself and for others. Take my hand and lead by example. Take my hand and walk beside me to show the world you were proud of me. But love and respect me enough to let go so that I might stand alone to show the world that I can." And here's Gary and his family, and I love this picture of Gary as a little boy with his very thick glasses. Penny Rosenblum from Arizona. The best thing my parents ever did for me was when I was 7 years old. They sent me to a camp for children with visual impairments, Camp Marcella in New Jersey. There I met other children who had trouble seeing just like me. But no one put emphasis on what we couldn't see, rather they emphasized that we were children who were capable. I think every parent should send their child to summer camp, whether or not that child has a disability. Let your child spread his or her wings and fly. Don't be a parent who holds your child back. And last, from Dave Wilkinson in Kentucky. I don't remember my mom and dad ever saying I couldn't do something, with the exception of driving, and then there are a few incidents they are blissfully ignorant about. My family figured I would discover my strengths and limitations through trial, error, and exploration, just as other children do. I've never been comfortable as a role model. Don't we do that a lot to people who are blind, make them role models? Do they really want to be role models? It's ironic, he goes on to say, because that's part of my job as someone who sells assistive technology, and it was an unspoken part of my job when I ran college residence halls. I think the reason I'm uncomfortable as a role model is that if I were sighted, a lot of what I've done wouldn't be viewed as that special or interesting. He concludes by saying, I think we'll have really made it when accomplishments of blind people run the same risk of being overlooked as so many other segments of society. So I want to leave you also with something to think about. This actually happened on the 19th, which was Friday, that the House of Representatives in the US, and I know some of you are international, but I beg your indulgence on this. The House passed a rewrite of the No Child Left Behind bill and reauthorization of the No Child Left Behind Act. And there are several things that you should all be concerned about in that act. Among them are that it reduces accountability for students with disabilities. IDEA has accountability in it, but that came from the No Child Left Behind Act. That act was passed first, and then IDEA was reauthorized in 2004. No Child Left Behind was 2001. But that accountability provision, and including kids with disabilities in that accountability provision, the House just threw out. They didn't think that was important. They eliminated the 1% cap on alternate assessments based on alternate achievement standards. So that means that more kids might be excused from statewide testing and accountability that comes with that statewide testing because that cap is no longer there. It eliminates highly qualified teacher provisions. That doesn't make me happy. Does that make you happy? It promotes privatization of education, which can be a good thing, but when you privatize, then you don't have those federal rules that structure what you do. It excludes the Keeping All Students Safe Act, and it ignores the needs of high-ability students. So what will happen next is that the Senate will pass its version of the reauthorization of the No Child Left Behind Act, and the two houses of Congress will then conference to pass a bill that's acceptable to both. Do you think that's going to be easy in this Congress? It's not going to be easy at all. And there's probably going to be a lot of compromise if it ever gets reauthorized. If it doesn't get reauthorized, everything is still in place. We all should care about this because IDEA and the No Child Left Behind Act, or what's called the Elementary and Secondary Education Act, are inextricably linked in terms of highly qualified teachers, in terms of accountability, in terms of statewide testing. They're very important pieces that have helped level the playing field for kids with disabilities. And I'm very concerned that's what's happened, and I hope you will be too. Never underestimate the power of parents, whether it's in a group like NAPVI, whether it's on a local level, a state level, or a national level. Do not underestimate your power, because you can do a lot to make things change. So write to your congresspeople and let them know that this bill needs to be changed.
It's not a question, it's a comment. I just want to encourage everyone, absolutely everyone who has not already done it, to get your hands on Kay's book, Reach Out and Teach. It is the Bible for any parent of a child with vision loss or vision loss and multiple disabilities. Once you read it, you'll understand why the American Foundation for the Blind gave Kay the Lifetime Achievement Award last spring. That book alone, much less all of her other superb writing and research, make that reward richly deserved. And all I can say is we can't wait for what next Kay will be producing to keep up with the excellent research she's doing. So a huge thank you.
Thank you. David, do you think you could be my business manager?
Take care.
Hi. I also just want to make a comment about, as a concrete example of what we've learned from your book and your emphasis on the body planes and the laterality, that you don't have to make this, okay, we're going to have a lesson now. And from your book, every time we're at a playground on a swing, and I know many of you have blind children who like to swing and swing for a long time, and they won't get off the swing. Every single push, I'm going to push your left knee. Next one, I'm going to push your right shoulder. Every single push, there's a laterality and a body part. And we went for her 2-year-old checkup, and she wasn't even talking. And they said, does she know 6 body parts? I said, try 50. Try corpus callosum. Try, spine, everything. And because of your book, we've incorporated that before she could talk, and just using every example. And so anyway, I love her book too, and I think you all should get it.
Jill and David, I met Jill for the first time last night, but the interesting thing is, you talk about 6 degrees of separation. We have a mutual friend at Jill's university. There's a woman who teaches in the deaf education program, and she and I did our doctorate together. So it's really neat to make those ties across everybody, really, across the world. Other questions?
Any parents have some questions?
Yeah, it'll take a minute. It's K-A-Y dot F as in Frank, E-R-R-E-L-L at I'm waiting for your thumb to catch up. K dot Ferrell at UNCO. The O is very important. If you just put UNC, it'll go to North Carolina. So put UNCO dot EDU.
Just want to give you all just one more little task to do when you go home. And that is, how many of you have a teacher of the visually impaired that works with your child? I want you to go home and let them know that you came to a parent conference this weekend and you heard this woman, Kay Ferrell, speak. Gee, do you know who she is? And if your TVI doesn't know who Kay Ferrell is, there's a problem. 20, 30 years ago, I started out in this field. I worked in the early intervention program at Perkins School for the Blind, and I got to tell you, in terms of teacher prep, I had no idea what I was doing. I walked into homes with little tiny babies that had, I mean, all kinds of issues, prematurity, whatever, and if it wasn't for Kay Ferrell's work, I would have been a lost ship at sea. So again, I just want to thank you so much. Your words really mean so much to me. And from the beginning of that work that I read so many years ago, you have always put parents at the forefront, and it's a thread that's gone throughout all of your research, all of your writings, and all of the gifts that you've given to the field. And I'm just very grateful as an old TVI. So again, go back and test your TVIs and make sure they know who Kay Ferrell is. So thank you. Just a couple of other things I want to let you folks know for those of you who have a child that has combined vision and hearing loss. There is a very large grant that is connected with the FCC, and your child and your family may be eligible for free technology. That means computers and all kinds of wonderful technology supports at no cost. So if you have any questions regarding that, the program is I Can Connect. I have a flyer. I'm more than willing to pass this out to those of you who are interested. But it really is a wonderful, wonderful grant that's available. I'm talking computers, internet access, laptops, all kinds of stuff at absolutely no cost to you and your family. So it's really important that you use that. Secondly, again, we're looking for letters of support. Our grants are up, and we'd love to know how we may be able to support you in the future. We will be sending all of you a survey online so we can figure out, you know, what worked for you, what didn't work for you, how we can kind of grow and foster the seeds that we've sown this weekend. Last but not least, I just want to tell you how grateful I am for connecting with the Guild and with Susan LaVenture. And Susan, you've just been a godsend. As I have been so torn and distraught over my grant writing, she's always been like, it's okay, we'll take care of it. And that's, it's just been wonderful. Thank you to all of our family specialists and to Jenna and Mike Morris for their couples and moms and dads presentations. And thank all of you for coming and just networking and sharing and supporting one another. It's been a great weekend. Thank you.